Welcome to Walter Hall at the University of Toronto's Faculty of Music. My name is Sandra Horst, Director of Musical Studies for Opera, and I'm very happy to be hosting this preview, as well as conducting our upcoming performances of Aaron Copland's The Tenderland, taking place from March 17th to 20th. I would like to begin by acknowledging this land on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and the Mississaugas of the Credit. Today, this meeting place is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. One of the few, and certainly the most well-known, of Aaron Copland's operas, The Tenderland, was commissioned in 1954 by Richard Rogers and Oscar Hammerstein II for the 30th anniversary of the League of Composers. The story is inspired by Walker Evans and James Agee's account of Southern sharecropping families in 1936, as they are depicted in the book, Now Let Us Pray's Famous Men. Set in the Midwestern United States in the 1930s, Copland's music and Horace Everett's libretto weave the tale of a lower-class farming family at the time of harvest and high school graduation. The opera opens with Ma Moss and her youngest daughter Beth as they both ponder the passage of time that graduation signifies, combined with the excitement of receiving a mail-order package containing a very special dress. Here is Alex Hetherington and Emily Rasha as Ma and Beth.
So Ma Moss lives on the farm with her two daughters and her father. She's become somewhat emotionally hardened by the experiences in her life, but she loves her daughters fiercely and does everything in her power to make them safe and happy and to give them a better life than she has.
Beth is the youngest Moss daughter. She is a few years younger than her sister Lori, who she admires a lot. Beth is curious, imaginative, joyful, and she loves her family so much.
Oh,
finds herself with many questions leading up to her graduation. Here is Heidi Duncan as Lori.
Lori Moss is the eldest daughter of the Moss family. She's a young woman full of ambition with big dreams and longs to experience the world outside the confines of her simple farm life. As her high school graduation approaches, she's desperate to be in charge of her own destiny and to embrace all that the world has to offer her.
Looking for a place to land and help with the harvest, earn some money, and move on. They run into Grandpa Moss, who agrees to take them on. Here is Angelo Moretti as Martin, Danley Ray Osebuke as Top, and Alex Matthews as Grandpa Moss.
Martin, like his buddy Top, is a good-hearted man who likes to work hard and play hard. That seems to be the theme between Top and Martin as they go town to town looking for a place to work, hopefully a good plate of food, and maybe even a good drink. But unlike his buddy Top, Martin has a more of a sensitive side as he longs for a place to settle down, a house to call home, and a wife by his side.
Top is older than Martin. He's a very hardworking man who likes to work in the fields. He's a very charming drifter as well. But after a long day of work, he just likes to eat and drink.
Grandpa Moss is the patriarch of the Moss family. He owns the farm on which the opera takes place, and he is skeptical of strangers. He makes his own berry wine as well. He's a bit of a Renaissance man in that regard. And when these two drifters come onto the farm, he is not entirely sure he trusts them.
I need a couple of men, but I don't know. I keep shy of strangers, they bring no good somehow.
A stranger may seem strange, that's true, but did it ever occur to you that you seem strange to a stranger, seem strange to a stranger, seem strange to a stranger too?
Potatoes are planted in the rain.
We hope you can see it our way. We're not strange to work now. What do you say? Will you take on a stranger?
When you put it like that, I'll have to admit you're right for the work, and besides it fit, you're not such a stranger, not such a stranger, not such a stranger.
And that's what you need to work these lands.
I'm getting tired by your book young. Your songs begin in words but sung. Are you willing to work for your pay?
So be willing to work for our pay.
Then I'll make a special exception this day and hire a stranger.
Will you hire a stranger?
Returning to the opera division, where he has staged Songs of Love and War, Last Days, Handel's Imeneo, and, cut short by the pandemic, Jonathan Dove's Mansfield Park. In Toronto, his productions have been seen at the Canadian Opera Company, Tapestry Opera, and Soundstreams. Internationally, he has directed highly acclaimed productions for such companies as English National Opera, Opera North, the Metropolitan Opera, Santa Fe Opera, and the epic Peter Grimes on the Beach for the Albro Festival in 2013. Welcome, Tim. We look forward to hearing your concept of the staging and design for our production of The Tenderloin.
Thank you, Sandra. When Michelle Tracy, the set and costume designer for our show, and I started working on The Tenderloin, the design of it, we of course looked at the photographers that Sandra was mentioning at the beginning, in particular Walker Evans, and we came across a rather extraordinary photograph, black and white of course, of a huge billboard, sort of shabby billboard, about maybe 30 foot wide, 20 foot high, built by the side of a dusty country road in the Midwest. And on the billboard was an advertisement for a furniture company with sort of brand new 1930s furniture on it, but it was still in the middle of this sort of dusty highway in the middle of nowhere. And it seemed to us to express something about the tension in the opera, that tension that's grown since the beginning of industrialization between the land, nature, living in harmony with the fields and with the crops, and then the growth of the city. And along with that, the growth of education for all people and not just for the select privileged few. So we have Laurie, our main character, who's just graduating, the first of her family to do so. But we have Grandpa, who's stuck with the land. And the opera itself seems to kind of exist with this tension, and it never quite resolves it. Laurie goes off at the end to seek another life and another place with broader horizons, but the farm goes on. And its emotional heart of the opera seems to rest with the land, which you will hear in the final ensemble that I think we're going to sing today, in which it's a kind of hymn to the idea of living in harmony together and in harmony with this year's crop, which is about to be harvested. So this billboard with this advertisement for consumer goods placed in a farm piece of farmland seemed to us to express something about the opera. It also allowed us to escape, we thought, the realism of the front porch, the country house, which you're kind of stuck with all evening. And the piece is about dreams. So we are able then to change the imagery on this billboard to try to mirror and express the dreams of the characters. So Laurie dreams of what's beyond the horizon, and we see this country road stretching away, away into the distance. She talks of, is there a place where the dancing never ends at the party when they're all dancing? And we see a landscape of 1930 Chicago drifting across our sight line. And in this wonderful ensemble at the end of the first act, when they sing this hymn to nature, we see this glorious green field, which as the sun sets, which it is doing in the opera, gradually changes into a sunset over the fields and then into a starry night with the dark fields. So we're able to express something about the inner landscape of the characters whilst also dealing with the necessary realism of the piece. So hopefully we found a way of expressing its external narrative but also harnessing something of the inner hopes and longings of the main characters.
Thank you, Tim. Central to the story of the opera is the love that blossoms between Laurie and Morton. Caught up in the magic of celebration and hope, they form a bond and dream of a life together, filled with adventure and happiness, as they realize that they are each searching for something more in their life. Here is Noelle Slaney as Laurie and David Walsh as Martin.
Till harvest time.
as the Dean of American Composers. His compositional style consists of open and slowly changing harmonies that have been associated with the vastness of the American landscape and the pioneer spirit. Many of his most popular compositions are based on American folk tunes, which either form the basis of the melody, as in his use of a Shaker hymn in Appalachian Spring, or the cowboy songs that are woven into the rhythm and atmosphere of his ballet, Billy the Kid. Lincoln Portrait and Fanfare for the Common Man have become symbolic of American patriotism, while his settings of old American folk songs highlight the value he placed on preserving American poetry and plays. As we conclude our presentation today, I would like to invite you to join us on the Faculty of Music's YouTube channel next Thursday through Sunday, March 17th to 20th, as we present for free the live stream of Copland's opera, The Tender Land. Many thanks today to Dean Ellie Hisama, Tim Albury, Christina Bell, Spencer Krasinowski at the piano, and the talented students of the Opera Division who you have just heard. Not only for their performances today, but for the extraordinary commitment to this production and the study of opera in these challenging times. We leave you with the finale of Act One of The Tender Land, where Lori, Beth, Ma, Grandpa Moss, Martin, and Top sing hopefully of the promise of living, born of our loving our friends and our labor, fitting words for our time. Thank you for joining us. Here are Noelle Slaney, Taylor Donald, Alessia Vitali,